Hey everyone, welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is a show where we talk about all things screenwriting. I'm your host, Sade Sellers. On today's episode, we have an interview with Robert Eggers and Sjón for The Northman.
How I've missed you, my son. One day this kingdom will be yours.
Thank you, Father. My king.
Robert, Sjón, and I chatted about tips for writing with a partner, multitasking as a writer, and tackling heavy themes within your screenplay. Check it out. All right, everyone, this is The Northman, and I'm so excited to talk with the co-writers, Sjón and Robert Eggers. Hi. Hi, everyone. Hi from Prague. Hi from Iceland, right?
Yep. Yep.
Do you have any room in that house over there? Can I join you and get out of California a little bit?
Well, you'll tire of the cold pretty soon, I guess, you know, but it will be good. It will be good 15 minutes for you.
Yeah, I don't know. If you guys got free healthcare, I'll take cold over that, you know, yeah. Anytime. Okay, so I want to first by saying this is an amazing movie. And I actually wanted to share my little story. My journey to this movie has been long and it's been a process. I tried to see this movie 3 times in the theater. The first time I got sick with COVID, right? Couldn't see it. The second time, my best friend canceled on me and I was like, all right, she's not coming, I'm not coming. And then the third time, there was actually a fire at the AMC theater and we had to evacuate. And then at that point, I said, well, maybe it's just not for me. Like, maybe I'm not meant to see the movie. But thankfully, because of this interview, I got to watch it from the comfort of my home and safe, COVID-free. And I instantly said to myself, damn, I wish I got to see this in the theater. So I want to ask, and I'll start with you. I mean, Robert, your work is masterful, and I'm such a huge fan of everything that you've done. But how did you two become co-writers? Like, how did the process, where did you meet? How did we get to start on the script of The Northman?
Well, I was on my first trip to Iceland ever. And my friend, Robin Carolyn, who's one of the composers on the film, suggested that I meet Björk while I was there because they had worked together before. And so, and I sort of said, it's okay, please, I don't need to bother Björk. But she texted me and invited me over for dinner, me and my wife, and said that she was inviting her friend, Sjón, and she thought we would get along. And you can take it from here, Sjón.
Yeah, yeah. So we met there for salmon. Björk cooked us salmon, and we were just introducing ourselves to, you know, these new people, you know, and I didn't have a clue who Robert was, you know. I just knew this name Eggers, and Robert said, by the way, I'm not related to Dave Eggers, because that was the famous Eggers from the United States at the time, and nobody knew Robert. So I said, that's fine with me if you're not related to Dave Eggers, but what have you done? And Robert told me that he just premiered, or recently premiered, a film called The Witch that takes place in the late 17th century New England and is about witchcraft. And I said, well, it so happens that I've written a novel called From the Mouth of the Whale, and it takes place in Iceland at the beginning of the 17th century and also deals with witchcraft. And we realized that, you know, we had some things in common, and slowly we found our way together for The Northman when Robert, you sent me an email, I think, in the summer of 2017.
Yeah, I had a lunch with Alexander Skarsgård, who said that he wanted to make a Viking movie. And I said, I can make a Viking movie, and I know the perfect person to write it with me. And luckily, Sjón wanted to. So I sent him a treatment that was, you know, a version of what the film is, that based on Amleth, which is the old Norse a story that became Shakespeare's Hamlet. And then I went to Iceland. Sjón and I worked on a longer version. And then, you know, Sjón eventually broke the script, wrote the first draft. And from there, we just passed it back and forth for eternity, all through production, all through post-production.
Continuing to write. You're still writing today, legend has it. It's still being edited.
Yeah.
Let's talk technical process, because this is, you know, the Final Draft podcast. So you don't have to say you're writing on Final Draft. It's fine if you didn't. But I do want to know, since you were separated, what were you writing on? And like, what was the process of notes? Did you go back and discuss them, or did you freely make changes? Like, Sjón, how did it work for you on your end?
Yeah. So after we had the first draft, you know, we started sending it back and forth. That's what we did, you know, and we shared notes, you know, and intentions. Robert had a go at it, you know, went at it with a red marker. And, you know, we just kept sending it back and forth. And because English is not my first language, I knew from the beginning that Robert would be more in charge of getting the dialogues in shape, you know, so even though I wrote like suggestions for dialogues, Robert took them further, you know. And yeah, we just shared back and forth. I mean,
were you writing dialogue in the Nordic language, like in the characters?
No, but there are names of places, names of the gods, names of people, you know, that we were referring to and using.
Yeah. Wait, that's interesting. Okay, so I want to talk about, and I'll ask you this, Robert. You have any tips for our listeners who are writing with partners? Like, what would your top three tips be in terms of collaborating on the script?
You know, to be humble and not defensive, I think is super important. I think, you know, over communicating is important. And then, you know, I mean, when I'm writing a script alone, I enjoy like getting lost in the ether of like what it is I'm trying to do. But, you know, when this isn't news to anybody, but you, when you're working with a writing partner, you do have to plan it first. Mm-hmm. You know, obviously there are ways in which you can kind of decide to not plan certain things, but you got to have a roadmap and actually, you know, and this is, Sjón and I have been continuing to collaborate on other things, and you know, hopefully they get made. But I think as we've been moving forward, like having the real clear roadmap enables us to work efficiently.
Yeah, I think that must be one of the most important things when you're collaborating, to have the roadmap, which is like the treatment or like the step outline. You know, you get it more or less in place before going for the first draft. But then there's another thing that is so important and has been so important in our working relationship, and that is creating like the compost heap that we feed on, you know, that we where we seek our inspiration, you know. And we really work on making lists of books, films, music, poetry, visual art. So in a way, we use that to get into the same mental space. I think we create like a universe of references. If I write a scene that would look completely out there to someone coming to it out of the blue, you know, I mean, Robert understands that this is a reference to that type of cinema or that type of illustrations from the whatever 19th century, you know. So I think, you know, creating that shared universe is very important.
And Sjón, what, if you can recall, what's the timeline for like, you meet Robert, Alexander wants this movie to happen, there's a script done. Like, what was that timeline?
Well, it's 2 years more or less, you know, because I think, like I said, it was in the summer of 2017 that Robert sent me the email, and we met in Reykjavik in August, I think. And then, if I remember correctly, we got like the proper first draft together just before you went to Cannes in 2019 with The Lighthouse. So it's 2 years more or less that, you know, it took us to get like the first draft that we presented to the studio.
Yeah. And then we were in prep that fall.
Oh, wow.
Luckily, the script was in good shape, and luckily The Lighthouse was a success at Cannes.
Well, yeah. it did kind of well, yeah. That always helped. And then luckily, I mean, not luckily, but you already had like a powerhouse actor who was like, yeah, I want to do this. So I want to ask Robert, what comes first in the process of writing? Is it, okay, we have this actor, we write around him, or we're going to build this character, we know this actor can do this?
Yeah, I mean, it's both. And certainly he's the right person for the role. So it wasn't, you know, it was easy enough, you know, but, you know, we wrote Hamer the Fool, you know, with Willem in mind, and we wrote Olga with Anya in mind, and Guthrin became Nicole pretty quickly. Yeah. You know, a lot of people said yes. So
the stacked cast, it's intimidating when I watch it. I'm like, this is a lot. This is a lot on screen. And they're so good at what they do. And then you got Bjork to come on.
Yeah. She was sort of like the fairy godmother, of the whole project by bringing us together in the first place. So I think it was you, Robert, that like said, you know, this Tlawitz, you know, has to be Bjork. And then we started working on that. And it wasn't easy because, I mean, she's a very close friend. I mean, we've been friends since we were teenagers, you know, and we worked together on so many different projects. But she had been very, very clear on never acting in a film again after she did Dancer in the Dark. So we knew it was going to be like, it would take some tricks and manipulations and humble magic requests and goodwill from the gods for her to come in, and she did.
And she's amazing, and everyone's really amazing in this film. I want to talk about Alexander's character, Amleth. I first would like to ask both of you, how is your relationship with your fathers? Because it's a lot happening in this movie about the sins of the dads. And I was like, I hope you guys are okay. Robert, like, are we okay with our dad? Like, what's happening here?
Yeah.
Okay, you're like, okay. Yeah, well, because actually, that's been my favorite. When I like to go through the Twitter conversations, and I love reading, I guess I don't love it, but I think it's really interesting. A lot of men who've seen the movie have been like, oh my gosh, this is like me and my father, this is how I feel about my family, or this is like, I connect to this so much. So I'm just very interested in how that theme translates for your personal lives.
I didn't grow up with a father, you know, so I grew up with a single mom and grew up with a very distant father, you know. Later in life, when I was grown up, you know, we had a wonderful relationship for a few years, and then he passed away. But I didn't grow up with a father. So I think for me, you know, I'm more exploring what could have happened if I had grown up with a father, with a strong father figure, mm-hmm. a strong, deeply flawed father figure, let's say, because I know that in my case, I would have been exposed to many difficult, dark, toxic things if I had grown up with him as a kid. He had become a wonderful man when we started our relationship later. So I'm sure it feeds in. I'm sure all of these elements feed in to creating something like that.
Yeah, and Robert, you were gonna say.
I was gonna say, like, weren't we both mama's boys? I had a great relationship with my dad, who's really my stepdad, but I didn't know my biological father. So it's also interesting because I'm fairly recently a father myself, which is also been. It's like 4 years ago now, but it's been weird to think about too, you know.
Mm-hmm. Is your child boy, girl? Can I ask?
Yeah, he's a boy.
Okay. So then, yeah, you're looking at this movie and it's talking about the sins of, you know, your father being passed down. And I'm sure you're looking, like you said, you're looking at your child going, oh my gosh, let me make sure I'm not passing down.
Yeah, for sure.
It's for scary. Sure.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting that, you know, we are at two different stages in our lives when it comes to that. My kids are, you know, grown up. My daughter is 30, my son is 23. You know, technically, I could have a kid Robert's age, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, and I think that's also interesting for us, you know, to come together as writers from two different places, you know, in the human life, you know. That's also interesting.
And I, again, even though I'm not a boy, I grew up without my father too, similar to you, Sjón, in the sense of like, I always wonder what that would be like if he was there, but also was that a blessing that he wasn't there? Because maybe it would have been a different and not so great experience. So I connected to the film in the sense of like, gosh, you sometimes, because I really connected with Amleth's quest to like, and we're not going to give it away, but to do this thing on behalf of his father and then realize like your parents aren't perfect. I think that's every adult's breaking point when they realize your parents are actually human and not these like Norse gods who.
Yeah, I'm not sure I would wish it upon anyone to have Gudrun and Örvandil as the parents.
But it's heartbreaking. And then I do. So Robert, I want to ask too, because, you know, you're going to direct this, you're co-writing it. When you're writing, do you take more liberties knowing that you're going to direct it to seed in like camera angles or any indicators for the screen, actually, for you as a director?
So a little bit, but not as much on this as some other scripts. And part of, you know, a big step in the process of the filmmaking is when I, you know, planned the shots with Jaron Blaschke, the cinematographer, who's the other major authorial voice, you know, in the movie, and he's often suggesting to like reorder beats and condense sequences to make it more cinematic, and it's a very great phase in the script writing process.
I think that's great because especially with. I've seen your other work as well. So I always wonder, like, as a collaborator, as a writer, how that translates different from your directing. But you're with a partner here, so I see the balance. Yeah.
Yeah, I found it interesting that Robert did not want me to write in any suggestions for framing or like moving the camera or whatever. I've done that in earlier scripts, you know. Then it's like, we see this, whatever, you know, we notice whatever, you know. But Robert was quite adamant on like, not using that kind of a language in the script. So if you want to point something out, you say, Olga sees Amleth coming, you know, that's what we need. You know, that's what Robert needs with Jaron, you know, and they will make it work visually. And in a way, it was quite liberating for me to not have to have that in mind, but more like just the flow of the scene. And of course, you know, in your mind, you place the characters within the scene, you stage it in a sense in your mind, but you know it's more about the relationships and the atmospheres for me as a writer, you know, when I'm writing it. And then, of course, knowing that I'm working with Robert, you know, I know that I don't have to worry about it not becoming something amazing.
yeah, exactly. You're already in good hands. So as we wrap up here, I mean, that's the end of our episode, and I'm really sad because I have 1,000 more questions I could ask you, but it would ruin the movie and I want people to see it. I have one last question for both of you, and I'll start with Robert, and it's, what advice do you have to your younger writer self, like Robert 10 years ago, or even, hey, yesterday?
I mean, I don't regret like my choices, but I wish, because they all lead to, you know, what's going on now, and you learn from your mistakes. But I suppose I could only write one thing at a time. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I could only focus on one story at a time. I would waste like 9 months writing something and then realize that it didn't work. And I think at the time I really felt like I needed to do that. Maybe I did need to do that. Maybe that was just part of my journey. But now I can multitask and have more than one pot on the stove. It's a little bit trickier at this very moment because I'm in prep, but generally I like that's enabling me to survive in this industry is by like having a lot of things going. So I guess, you know, learn to multitask. And I think it's particularly if you are like a screenwriter and not a writer director, you absolutely have to multitask. But I think maybe that kind of single-mindedness that I had like made it so I got The Witch made.
Yeah.
You know, if I was just like, got to make the witch for 5 years, like that was it, you know, maybe that was important, even though like I would totally like sink if that's how I behave now.
I think that's the number one struggle of all of our listeners is balance and writing, you know, between day jobs or family and life in general. So that's definitely what I relate to for sure. Yeah. Sjón, what about you? Advice for your younger writer self?
Just enjoying the relationship with your co-writer. I really recommend working with a co-writer on films. You know, I've written poetry and novels and all sorts of things. But when it comes to film, I really think it works when you're writing with someone, you know, because film is already a medium of collaboration. And to go into it like from the beginning, from the story level, as a collaboration, I think is really, really great. And then, you know, my real advice is if you're a young writer, go and find someone like Robert to work with.
Yes, yes. Find those hidden Robert gems out there, you guys, if you can swing it. Thank you both so much for coming on the show. Everyone, The Northman, you can rent it on VOD or on Amazon. Actually, it's on Amazon right now. Sit down, grab some popcorn and really enjoy. It's an amazing epic tale. Again, I don't know why the gods wouldn't let me see it in theaters, but that's okay. I got to see it anyway, so I'm very grateful for that. Thank you both for coming on the show, and I hope you come back in the future on your next one.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Huge thanks again to Robert and Sjón for coming on the show. You can now watch The Northman streaming on VOD. Please go check it out.
And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review, and if you haven't already, subscribe to the show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcast. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Emma Branich, edited by Sjón Bonnet, music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, write on.